Welcome everybody to a new episode of Beyond the Patterns. Today I have the great pleasure to have Ivana Iskum from the University of Amsterdam as guest. So she will present today an invited presentation entitled Deep Learning for Automatic Detection of Cardiovascular Disease in CT and MR Exams. Ivana is a professor of AI and medical imaging at the Amsterdam University Medical Center at the University of Amsterdam. In fall 2018, she started as scientific lead of the company QuantibU. Ivana Iskum graduated in mathematics at the University of Zagreb, Croatia in 1999. She obtained her PhD degree at the Image Science Institute in 2007 with a thesis entitled Computer-Aided Detection and Quantification of Arterial Calcifications with CT. She was a postdoc at the Laboratory for Clinical and Experimental Image Processing in Leiden University Medical Center and subsequently assistant and associate professor at UMC Utrecht, where she was leading the quantitative medical image analysis group at the Image Sciences Institute. In 2019, Ivana was appointed full professor and moved with her group to University of Amsterdam. Her group is focusing on the development of algorithms for quantitative analysis of medical images to enable automatic patient risk profiling, diagnosis, and prognosis using AI techniques. Ivana is the recipient of several large grants, has presented extensively in the medical imaging conferences and published in scientific peer-reviewed journals, and is also a very active member of our MIKAI community. So it is a great pleasure to have her here in the series. And Ivana, the stage is yours.
Thank you for a very kind introduction. I am university professor of AI medical imaging, which means that I work at the university, not at faculties, and my task is to develop AI methods that can be implemented in clinic in a responsible, socially responsible way. But as my background is in image analysis, my group is located at the Department of Biomedical Engineering and Physics at the University Hospital in Amsterdam. And a very important topic in my research is analysis of cardiovascular images. And today I will present, as just introduced, work that we have done or that we are doing on CT and MR. So the presentation, I have divided it in two parts. Is that these are relatively independent. So I would like to start with analysis in CT. So a very short introduction. Cardiovascular disease is leading cause of death and disability worldwide, and fatal cardiovascular events like heart infarction or stroke are often the first manifestation of the disease. At the same time, subclinical signs of the presence of the disease, so in the stage when the disease doesn't give any symptoms, are visible in medical images, often as requested or unrequested findings. So in some images which are made for any other reasons, these signs are often visible. However, current workflow in clinic that requires a lot of manual analysis and manual interaction with images doesn't allow very detailed identification or detection of these signs when they are not clinically relevant yet. And this is especially the case, or maybe I'm not sure if this is especially the case, but this is also often the case in coronary artery disease. Coronary artery disease is a type of cardiovascular disease caused by plaque buildup. This plaque can be calcified and non-calcified in the wall of the coronary arteries. And here you see a slice from a CT scan, which shows this white, bright area that resembles the bone in the coronary artery. So that's the calcified plaque. And this is important because the amount of these coronary calcifications, it's called calcium score, is a very strong and independent predictor of myocardial infarction. So just quantification of these calcifications in the coronary arteries, so in the arteries of the heart, can predict whether somebody is at risk of infarction, independent of, for example, the typical risk factors that are measured, like hypertension, presence of diabetes, increased levels of lipids. And because of this, calcifications are nowadays in the coronary arteries quantified routinely in calcium scoring CT. Calcium scoring CT is a CT of the heart, which doesn't have contrast enhancement, so it allows good visualization of these calcifications. But because of the importance of this, reporting of the burden of the calcium in the arteries on all non-contrast CT examinations is now endorsed by joint guideline from the Society of Cardiovascular Computed Tomography and Society of Thoracic Radiology. What this actually means is that in every scan that is showing the heart, like for example chest scan, this calcium score should be determined. So the relevance of coronary artery calcifications is very clear, but we also know that atherosclerosis is a systemic disease, which means that if calcifications are present in coronary arteries, they will likely be present also in other arteries in the body. And extracoronary calcifications like those in the aorta or heart valves also indicate increased risk of cardiovascular disease and risk of all-cause mortality. So in my group, we have worked quite a lot on calcium scoring in lung screening CT. This is interesting because, well, first, lung screening is screening many subjects, and acquires chest scan, which shows the heart. And it is performed in heavy smokers, and heavy smoking is risk of, it gives risk of developing lung cancer, but also is a risk factor for developing cardiovascular disease. And we have seen in the national lung screening trial, so it's the US screening trial for lung cancer. And we have also seen this in the trial in the Netherlands, that cardiovascular disease is a leading cause of death in heavy smokers. So about the same number of subjects included died of cardiovascular disease as of lung cancer. So in the screening, chest CT is acquired primarily for lung visualization. So the acquisition is tuned to that. But next to lungs, it shows very well heart and large arteries. And calcium can be identified in those arteries and it can be quantified. So you see here the bright spots pointed by white arrows. Those are the calcifications. So a while ago, Nicholas Lesman was a PhD student in my group, and he developed a method that can automatically segment and quantify calcifications that are present in these chest scans. So those were coronary arteries, aorta, aortic and mitral valves, and the scans were low dose, which often means they had quite a lot of noise. So Nicholas developed a two-stage approach where first he used dilated CNN, which allowed us to use large receptive field with relatively limited number of parameters. And the large receptive field was important to for the network to be able to assign the labels of the lesions according to location. So what you could see, the result is that this scan has, or this slice, there are two calcifications, one in the ascending aorta and one in the coronary artery. So the network detected that correctly, labeled, found them and labeled according to the location they're in, but also found a lot of false positives, like, for example, here, a piece of spine that was labeled as a calcification in the aorta. It is very close, but it's still not correct. So the label, what we have seen, the detection had very high sensitivity and anatomical labels were correct, but we had also many false positives. So then this was followed by, we call it normal CNN, but CNN that had a small receptive field and could perform a very local analysis and served as a false positive detector. And nice about this study was that it was in screening scans, so we had a lot of images. In this study, we included almost 1,700 scans. And very nice about it is that the images were very diverse. They were acquired in 31 hospitals by 13 different CT scanners. And as you can see here, two examples, the image quality was very diverse. And we were not so much interested in detecting every voxel that might represent calcifications, because also in some low quality images, like here in the bottom, that would be nearly invisible. But we wanted to assign subjects to risk categories, and those are standard, and the amount of calcium basically determines the risk group, which goes from very low to very high of a subject having a risk of heart infarction. And then when we evaluated the method and looked at the assignment to risk categories based on manual annotations and automatic, we have seen that linear elevated kappa for automatic method was above 0.9, so it was 0.91, and this suggests that the method can be used in screening with low-dose chest CT. And then we have published this method, and as I have been working on this topic for a long time, clinicians would often come to us and ask us to score calcium in a bit different set of images. And every time we had to either say, well, we have to retrain, so that would mean that we need manual annotations. Getting these manual annotations is, well, not so trivial. It took us very long time to collect the training data to perform the study I just described. So at some point we had requests to score calcium in cardiac CT. So you see here, this is very nice image with high resolution. It really optimized to detect calcifications. Then we had chest CT scans from clinic, and those are very different than those from the screening because the population is completely different. There can be a lot of pathology in the lungs, which makes analysis a very different task. Then we had attenuation correction CT scans that are acquired with cardiac PET, and scoring calcium in these images would be very interesting because normally this cardiac CT has to be made in addition to PET to determine the presence of calcium. And radiotherapy planning CT scans in breast cancer patients, because we know that treatment influences the cardiovascular disease, that many patients undergoing radiotherapy treatment suffer later from cardiovascular disease. So we then wanted to design one method that can be used in all the images, so we don't have to adjust every time. And then Sanne van Velzen, also a PhD student in my group, investigated whether she can train the method that Nicolas developed and maybe adjust it somehow so we could have one method. So she did several experiments. She first evaluated performance when the method was trained as is on lung screening trial data. Then she collected a small representative set from every data set we had, which would be then easy to label. So she added it to the training data, and that would be, let's say, a fast, a feasible solution. And ideally, we would want to combine all training data and use one method for any CT scan. And then here you see the evaluation result, or one of the results from the study is linearly weighted kappa for the agreement between manual and automatic method for total coronary artery calcification. And what we see is basically that combined method leads to very high linearly weighted kappa and suggests that the method can indeed be employed in clinical analysis and used for any scan that shows the heart. The problem With calcium scoring is that inter-scan variability is very high. In dedicated scans, so those that are really made for calcium scoring, it has been reported a difference for volume is up to 18%. And in scans which were not dedicated, like chest scans, this goes up to 61%. And this is a problem because it can lead to different risk category assignment and consequently to different patient management, I would say. So then we looked at the causes of variability. And we know it can be image noise, it makes it very difficult to see. It can also be partial volume effects because image resolution is not always the same. Artifacts can be definitely are caused by a cardiac motion. And lesions are clinically defined as intensity values above 130 Hounsfield units. So there is always this cutoff threshold on intensity values that makes it actually questionable whether we always, our visual assessment of calcifications agrees with a clinical definition. So we looked into this. So first we looked at the handling image noise, and handling image noise is important, especially if you want to reduce the radiation dose. So here's a slice from cardiac CT, and the dose is below 1 millisievert. So it's not high dose, but if you would want to implement this in screening, that would be potentially problematic. And it is also always useful to reduce the dose. However, you see here that using clinical process with the thresholding and then region growing by identifying a seed point at a calcified lesion, calcium scoring can be done very easily. Then we had a study in which we acquired images with about 4 times lower dose. So you see here, this image is an image of the same patient acquired on the very same day, but the image is very noisy. And then clinical calcium scoring procedure doesn't work because the region growing would connect nearly everything in the scan and we get unreasonably high score. So then Yelmer Woltering developed a method in which he used the GAN approach. So we had 2 separate acquisitions, high dose and low dose. And what he then did, used low dose image as input and generated denoised image in generator and then used the discriminator to differentiate between real denoised image and routine dose image. The trick here was that in the generator, we didn't generate denoised image, but we generated noise and then subtracted noise from the input image and obtained denoised image. And in this way, we are at least heavily minimizing risk that the generator would hallucinate information that is in the image or is not in the image. And here you see these 2 images that we had. So there is no voxel correspondence between them, and registering them with very high accuracy would be very difficult. So we then used this approach in which we don't require that. And here you see the result. So this is the input image, low dose image, and then denoised image. And you see that here calcium scoring is not possible. We also see that this image is not really exactly the same as true acquisition with regular dose, but it does allow calcium scoring, and we have tested this in a paper. You can see the results on patients and on phantom, and we were quite happy with the results. Okay, here we solved image noise, but there are also different other causes of variability that I mentioned. And it is hard to really decouple them because they're quite intertwined and related to each other. And then here you can see an example of 2 scans of 1 subject with 3 months interval. And in the first scan, you see calcification very nicely visualized. And in the second, there was a cardiac motion. So the calcification is quite blurry and we cannot really see where the boundaries are. And calcium scoring using clinical protocol in the first scan assigns the subject to highest risk category and in the second scan to intermediate risk category. Well, and you can see the difference in score is very high. So this would indeed potentially lead to very different management of the disease. So to address this, Sanne van Velzen said, well, we can have a bit different approach where we take image with calcium and decompose it into, we call it health image, but it's not really appropriate term, say image without calcium and a calcium map. So how to do this? Sanne used a cyclogram approach where she, because we also here, we cannot use a CNN. We don't have two images, one healthy and one unhealthy. So we have to somehow combine images with calcium and without calcium of different patients. So she did, she takes image, real image with calcium and generates again calcium map. So she doesn't generate immediately a synthetic image without calcium, because that would indeed, again, like in the previous example, be prone to the hallucination of abnormalities or removing some abnormalities. And this way we subtract a calcification calcium map from the input image and obtain this non-calcium image and then use a discriminator which has to tell apart synthetic from real image without calcium. And then in the backward path, she goes from no calcium domain to real calcium domain. So she takes image without calcium, then generates calcium map, plausible calcium map, adds these two images together to obtain synthetic image with calcium, and then uses a discriminator to separate those two. So here you can see some results. So this was presented at the conference earlier this year. So this is relatively still preliminary work. Here's an example of an image with calcification in the right coronary artery where you see there was also cardiac motion. The calcification is very blurry. And the clinical protocol doesn't find any calcification, while we see that there is obviously something in the artery. And the proposed method generates something that I would say finds something that is in agreement or at least more in agreement with our visual assessment. And another example, which is similar in the right coronary artery, and right coronary artery has typically these kind of artifacts, where the clinical method only finds one pixel, so only one pixel is above the required threshold, but the proposed method generates, gives a more reliable estimate. We also see that there is some spurious response in the image out of the calcification, so we thresholded this, and well, Sam is working on solving this further. We evaluated this, so the question is also how can we evaluate, because we don't have a reference standard, we don't know what is the truth, but we had images that were acquired, so scan and rescan to two images of same patient. And we looked at the relative difference in the mass between calcifications. And the blue is using a clinical method and red is proposed method. So you see that in some cases or more, many cases, this difference decreased. Note here that we don't expect perfect result. It is not expected we can solve everything by these problems. In some cases, calcification really can be out of the field of view and it is not shown in the image, while in the other it is, and this method cannot address this. Anyhow, we were quite encouraged with these results to continue working, and Sanne has done quite a bit on extending this, and the paper is now under review. Okay, the next topic that we worked on with CT is the following. We calcium scoring CT, so cardiac CT without contrast enhancement, is primarily or maybe only used to score calcium. But when these images are made and patient was already irradiated, we wondered whether we can extract more information from these images. And for some clinical research, it would be interesting to delineate cardiac structures. But delineating, like manually asking an expert to delineate ventricles and atria and large vessels in these images is not realistic. because the boundaries between the structures are unclear. Like here, we just don't see where the boundary is. But we also know that spectral CT scanner allows acquisition of image with contrast, so CT angiography, which very well visualizes cardiac structures, and that it also allows synthesis of generating virtually non-contrast CT, so CT which is coming from the same acquisition, but contrast is removed. And next to that, we typically acquisition has contrast enhanced scan and non-contrast enhanced scan. So we also see that this virtual non-contrast scan is not, it doesn't have exactly the same appearance as non-contrast scan, but we did the following. We used it to train our methods to segment non-contrast scans. In scan with contrast enhancement, we can manually annotate cardiac structures. And because this virtual scan has pixel-to-pixel correspondence with contrast scan, we could only copy the segmentations made here to scan without contrast, where this segmentation cannot be made. And then we trained the CNN to perform the segmentation in these same scans, virtual non-contrast scans, but also in regular non-contrast scans that were made as a separate acquisition and that are standardly used. So we had two sets of images, one that were of 18 patients that were made on Philips Icon, so spectral CT, and they had two acquisitions with contrast and without contrast. And then we had also validation cohort, a large set of more than 200 patients with a standard scanner and two acquisitions. And here we cannot create non-contrast image. So only in the first study, we had manual annotations also because time it is very time consuming to annotate the images, but we segmented left ventricular cavity, right ventricle, left atrium, right atrium, left ventricle myocardium, aorta and pulmonary arteries. And then Stefan Boons, quantitative evaluation is also in the paper. I here really summarize the findings. In images where we didn't have segmentations and we couldn't perform quantitative evaluation of the method, we asked experts to assign each subject a result into grades 1 to 5, where 1 would be perfect segmentation and 5 would be complete failure. And here you see illustration in every column, 1 grade, and above 70% of subjects were assigned to the opposite, to the first two categories, which means that these segmentations could be used in clinic. Also, that segmentation really underperformed in images when there were metal implants. This was not trained with, and maybe if you would train with that, possibly the method could be better, but I also think this is really difficult, even if you would have to do it manually. And in the last case, anatomy was very different, and I think this might be require a bit different approach to solve the problem. And so now I have shown what we have done with CT scans without contrast. And this is all related to anatomy. But what about function? The question is, that we were wondering about is, can we use CT scans to evaluate cardiac function to some extent? Because normally it requires acquisition, for example, of MR or maybe ultrasound, depending on what the question is. And in patients who are going to undergo aortic valve implantation, 4D cardiac CT angiography images are made. So these images are used for planning the intervention, and they provide a wealth of information about the morphology of the heart throughout the cardiac cycle. So automatic segmentations through the cardiac cycle could potentially then provide more information about function of the heart. And for this, we would really need an automatic approach because manual segmentations would be completely unfeasible just time-wise. So Stefan Bruns took 12 scans from this study set in which we had 3D volume reconstructions in every 5% of cardiac cycle. So it gave us 21 volume per patient. And segmentations were manually done in 3D at end diastole and end systole. And then he developed, he used 3D full convolutional network and performed Lee-1 out experiments in which he had, well, basically then 12 networks that were trained only on end systole and 12 trained on end diastole. And he evaluated segmentation performance when only images were trained with either one of the phases or both networks were taken together and the results were merged, and evaluated both on end systole and diastole. And what we see here is that basically if the image is trained on end systole and applied to end diastole, it works it works well. But it is also possible to train on end diastole and segment end systole. The results are still quite reasonable, but combination of the two improves the performance. We had some outliers, and those were typically when the contrast enhancement in the image was below what is normally, or what was in, I would say what is usual to see. And for end diastole, the conclusions were the same. And here we segmented, what I didn't say, left myocardium and left ventricle, right ventricle, left atrium and right atrium. And after this, so this gave us basically 24 networks, which we could ensemble and use in the evaluation set. An evaluation set was much larger, 460 images, exactly the same acquisition protocol, but we didn't have 3D segmentations, but only one slice segmented in four phases through the cardiac cycle in 81 patients. And because we were interested in function, we had a subset of about 120 patients for whom we had ejection fraction from echocardiography, which is considered the reference. So we applied the ensemble and to the full cardiac cycle, and we evaluated this on these four time points that I have mentioned. Those were end diastole, end systole, mid diastole, and systole. And we can conclude, looking at the diastole coefficient and looking at the boundary of the segmentation, that simple ensemble trained on end systole and end diastole only generalizes quite well to other cardiac phases. Also here, we had some outliers, but those were indeed, again, mostly due to different contrast enhancement than in the training data. Then we also evaluated left ventricle volume automatically segmented through the whole cardiac cycle. And what we see is quite a smooth curve across the cardiac cycle, where it is the minimum then diastole and maximum the minimum and then systole and maximal at the end diastole. So this is what we also expect. And this also allowed us later to automatically identify end systole and end diastole, because our colleagues were PhD students at the cardiology department, they were doing this all manually. So this can also save some time. And in the end, we looked at left ventricle ejection fraction. Here you see Glennon-Altman plot, so difference between echo image, which is the reference, and our approach. And we see that, well, many points for many patients, the agreement is very good, but there are some outliers, and we specifically look at the outliers. And here you see the largest outlier on both sides. So the inspection of the images revealed us that segmentations in CT was correct in these cases. There are many reasons why the results can be off. There is also a difference between if MR and echo are compared, and both are considered, I would say, reference. So we are now going to look a bit further into this, why the, where the differences might be coming from. Okay, so I would close here with CT, and I would like to show what we are currently working on in the analysis of cardiac MR. So cardiac MR is used to extract quantitative measures that are used for evaluation, that or basically evaluate cardiac function like stroke volume, ejection fraction, and those are important because they are used to diagnose patients. And for extraction of these quantitative measures, segmentations of target structures, so those are left and right ventricle cavity and myocardium often, they provide the basis for the extraction of quantitative measures, at least automatically. And we have also developed a method that automatically segments these structures. And what we have seen that in many cases, segmentation is very good. So you see here in the right, in the green right ventricle, in blue left ventricle, and in brownish color myocardium. And here red are errors. So this is automatic result, and this is automatic result, but compared with the reference standard. And so what is in red is disagreement with reference. And I would say that this disagreement here along the boundaries is to be expected, and it is probably within the inter-observer variability. So I would think that these errors are not really important. But our method also generated results like this, where the right ventricle is completely wrong, I would say. So comparison with the reference standard here tells us that indeed we have a disagreement along the boundary, a structure boundary, but we have also these errors which are completely anatomically implausible. And if you would want to implement this method in a clinic, I don't think that anyone would be happy using it because it can generate results that experts would never make. So a few years ago, there was a challenge on ACDC challenge in conjunction with Mikhail. We also participated in this challenge the task was exactly the one I just described. And the results show that the top performing model generates anatomically implausible segmentations in 82% of the test patient volumes. So this is a problem for every automatic method. So to solve this, we aim to generate automatic segmentation and then follow it by automatic detection of image regions that show these segmentation failures. So we differentiate results that we call failures, those that really shouldn't occur and that are problematic, anatomically implausible, and we want to tolerate those small inaccuracies. So Jörg Sander, a PhD student also in my group, developed a segmentation CNN that gives segmentation results, and this is similar to example that I just showed. In error shows all the inaccuracies when we compare it with a reference standard. But his method also shows uncertainty map. And what we actually want is, so here it says knowledge-based filtering, maybe not the best term, but what we actually want is that these small inaccuracies, they are not important, we don't look at them, but we want to detect these red, very implausible errors. So then his automatic segmentation is followed by a second step where he takes uncertainty map and original image and to detect image regions, so here in yellow, that contain these errors. And here's only a very brief summary of our findings. So we compared results using only automatic segmentation. And then we also simulated correction of the identified errors by comparing it to the reference standard. So we assume that everything that was detected as error would be automatically or manually fully corrected according to the reference, which might not be the case for real. So this gives us upper bound of what is achievable given the automatic segmentation. And then in the last experiment, we actually asked an expert to manually correct the identified regions. It was not allowed to change any of the segmentations that were not identified by the method. So here you see how step distances. This paper was accepted last week and it has very detailed evaluation, but here I only show house of distance because that's probably the most relevant one. What you see here is results for left ventricle, right ventricle, left ventricle myocardium at end systole and diastole and end systole. And automatic results, you see that there are quite some outliers, like 15.7 millimeters is quite a lot. And if you do simulated correction, this is very much reduced. And expert results are, as we wished, in between the automatic segmentation and those corrected by an expert. So this study showed us that this two-step approach improved segmentation performance. However, it's worth noting that the results were statistically significant only when we simulated the approach, which is, as I said, not really a realistic case. But the results were much more appealing, visually appealing. And the combined approach in which we really asked the experts to correct the results led to tenfold reduction of time compared to fully manual expert segmentation. And the final thing I would like to mention today is evaluation of cardiac function with MR. So we know that high spatial resolution in general medical imaging is considered a really very important component for accurate diagnosis and prognosis based on images. And in acquisition of MR, there is always this trade-off between signal-to-noise ratio, spatial resolution, temporal resolution, and acquisition time. And here is a sagittal view of short axis acquisition, which is image that is really very much used in this evaluation. And you see here that we can see the anatomical structures, but we also know that this very blocky image hampers automatic motion analysis. And so, so what we actually want is to go from low through-plane resolution in cardiac MR to high through-plane resolution cardiac MR. And super resolution methods do exactly that. And there have been several supervised learning-based methods proposed for generating super resolution. So where low resolution is an input and high resolution image is generated, but there is also ground truth high resolution image, and those two can be compared and also can be used in training to compute the loss. But in clinic, often high-resolution images are just not available. So the task is then to generate low-resolution from low-resolution image, high-resolution image, without knowing what this high-resolution image should really be. So Jörg then did the following. He took two slices, two neighboring slices from short axis view images and encoded them. And then each slice is represented in a latent space with two points. And then we hypothesized that if we do some linear combination of these two points in the latent space and then decode this point, that we will create an image that is in between. And if this would work, then we can actually do this at, we can increase resolution as much as we want. We can generate as many slices here as we want in between. And we somehow also do have to evaluate our approach. So we took cardiac scans with 5 millimeter slice thickness, but we treated them as if they were images with 10 millimeter slice thickness. So in between slice, we took away. And we encoded these two images and then used this autoencoder to decode also input images, but also to generate, to synthesize this one in between. And here's the result. So you see the original slices as input. So two neighboring in this 10 millimeter scan, different 10 millimeter slice thickness scan. So we call them slice one and slice three because there is really this one in between that we ignored at the learning time. And we reconstructed them without encoder. And we see when we subtract these two images that the difference is quite resembles noise. And this suggests us that then the reconstruction is good. And then we looked at the slice in between that was synthesized. And here the difference shows structure, which is somewhat expected. And visual inspection or visual comparison of these two images gives us, well, result we are quite happy with. And we compared our autoencoder approach with other unsupervised methods that are considered to be the reference. So linear interpolation, B-spline interpolation, and Lanczos filter. And what we see is that the difference images in case of autoencoder contain less structure, I would say. So less high bright red or dark blue points. This suggests that overall reconstruction might be a bit better. And then when we focus on some regions like here around the myocardium, we see that at least in this case, the reconstruction is probably better than in other methods where the difference or distinction between two structures is not really well visible. So to conclude this part of the work is that what we see that high resolution 3D cardiac MRs can be created using only anisotropic images for training. So this is fully unsupervised approach. We also have seen in our evaluation that performance is affected by large variation of anatomy between adjacent slices. So this is something that we are now working on. And we have seen that latent space of autoencoders can be exploited to generate smooth interpolations. And I would stop here and thank you for your attention. And I'm happy to answer any questions.
Yeah, Ivana, thank you very much for this exciting presentation, and I have some applause for you. I hope you can hear it. So at least some knocking on the table.
Yeah.
So thank you very much, and there have already been a couple of questions in the chat, and in particular, what you showed with the calcium scoring is really very impressive, and also the CT denoising. And here is one question: whether you pose any, because you subtract the noise, and the idea is, of course, that you only want to subtract noise and nothing else from the image. And the question is whether you have any frequency constraint on that the noise is really noise, or could it also contain other things that are non-noise?
I think this refers to Ilmar Woltering's work where we generated, we did this noise reduction. Yeah, it was a while ago, but I think we for sure didn't have serious problems with structure. We evaluated different approaches, and we also looked at approach using only CNN, and there was more, if I remember well, there was more difficulty with what was actually coming out. And with this GAN approach, we were quite happy. I don't remember that we were seeing very large problems.
Cool. Yeah, it's very impressive work. And also the influence of motion is of course a huge problem in the scoring. And here Lina was asking, would it be possible to use an overall image quality measure to evaluate if there are motion artifacts and use it for correction of the calcium score so that you implicitly correct only?
Yeah, well, image quality would for sure be very useful to tell us whether there is motion or there is no motion, or images good for scoring, suitable for scoring or not. But I don't think this would give us correction, and I'm not sure how it would help us in correcting. Because ideally, we would correct, I guess, from raw data. Maybe in Sinogram space, this has been done in Hamburg, I think. We have only worked in image space. Maybe it could help us additionally to determine which scans are usable or give us some reliability score next to the calcium score to risk prediction, telling us whether the scan is should be maybe additionally inspected, or maybe this the results should be taken with some uncertainty. But anyhow, I think that quality control, not only for calcium scoring but for many applications, if we are going to implement the methods in the clinic, would be very important. And there are still, there's still a lot of space to do research there.
I completely agree. I think the image quality is maybe image source how reliable the estimate can be done at all. And that would be an interesting additional information, of course. Absolutely. But if you really piece the image into parts, then you can probably also still obtain some information that just from the being an artifact present or not is not as reliable. Completely agree. So Florian is asking us regarding the virtual non-contrast. And so the question here is, if you do dual energy, then you have the contrast and the virtual non-contrast always available. But I assume that you're also looking into cases where you don't have the virtual non-contrast, right? So
So we trained the method with images from the spectral scanner where we had virtual non-contrast scan. But when we applied them, we applied the method to this. We first, of course, applied the method to the same scans where we could do the segmentation and have quantitative evaluation. But the large set was applied to scans that were acquired on regular CT scanners, and we didn't have virtual non-contrast. We could theoretically segment contrast-enhanced images because there were also two acquisitions in the data per patient, so one with contrast and one without contrast. But this would not be good evaluation because I'm sure that the volumes would not agree. If especially if the images are made without ECG triggering, and if they even if they are made with ECG triggering, you're likely not in the same phase. And we see, for example, in the evaluation of how the left ventricle volume changes throughout the cardiac cycle, if you're a little bit off, the volume can be very different. So that's why we asked the experts to look at the segmentation when they were grading in non-contrast image, but they also could look at contrast-enhanced scan. So they could estimate, they could compare the two and see whether the results are good or not.
Absolutely.
It's anyhow also very difficult to evaluate, and this maybe some outcome, like if you would know what these measures that would be extracted from these are relating to, then we could do much better evaluation. But here we don't have real reference.
Yeah, absolutely. So this is because you do the imaging, of course, with some purpose, and then the actual diagnosis is, of course, the thing that you are actually looking for. Yeah. Yes, absolutely. Agree in all points. So Felix is asking, you have described some problems with outliers. Do you think it would be advantageous to detect and discard these cases if the system is applied in the practice in the clinical practice? Or do you think a system should be able to also handle those cases? And then, if first, what do you propose to detect the outliers? And second, how might you be able to cope with the outliers for your system?
So I think both would be important. So what I showed here was a conference work that's just accepted for presentation to conference early next year. But I think it will be important to do some intensity-based augmentation and make the method able to cope more with contrast differences. We now had images only from one scanner in our hospital, from our hospital, which means a single scanner, a single protocol. If you would go to a bit different hospital or a different scanner, very likely there will be different intensity values. So I think a simple way to check is add augmentations with respect to intensity values. It would always also be important or useful to have detection of outliers. Only it's not always so easy to know what an outlier is. In some cases where we can compute volumes and we see the volume is very off, yeah, that's relatively trivial to detect. But in some cases, I'm not sure if that would be really then outliers, but there could be errors that are subtle and not in the sense that they don't affect volume very much, but segmentation or the result may be inaccurate. And also, like I showed in cardiac MR, they can be quite implausible anatomically, and those errors we would not like to have. So it would be important to maybe look at anatomical do some anatomical analysis of the result and see whether shape is feasible or maybe constraint that they didn't account and incorporate that in the method. I think there are various approaches that could be used to deal with this.
Absolutely. There is one more question by Isan. Could you please explain a bit how you did generate the uncertainty map in the MRI cardiac segmentation? So.
Yes, so I on purpose didn't go into this because it would take a long time to explain. We did very many experiments, and the paper is on archive, so all the details can be found there. But I can briefly say that we looked into different kinds of uncertainty estimation. So patient networks with a dropout, Monte Carlo dropout, and then the very different settings in this. And there were many things that we investigated. And I would say that maybe the finding is that there is no one best way to achieve this. We see that automatic identification of regions is much more successful or has much more impact if our starting segmentation is weaker. If we have better segmentation result initially, then all these uncertainty maps don't help that much. Well, help, but they help, but not the impact is not so visible on the final result. And I also think this is quite early work in which we actually don't want to have automatic correction of regions that may correct errors. We would actually like to automatically correct these errors. But as we see communities working on these problems for many years, many researchers are working on this task, and in some cases it's really difficult. And also inter-observer variability in some cases is quite substantial. And typically image quality hampers this evaluation, the segmentation automatically by different methods.
Yeah, but for Esan, if he wants to learn all the details of the method, we could actually post the link to archive of the description of the video, then he can read it because I think he might be very interested in that paper. And
Yeah, I'm happy to do that. And also, I think all the papers that I have mentioned today, everything should be on archive or it's
Yeah, so I would like to put the links directly into the video description because I think if some people miss the live presentation, then they might also be interested in the recording and then still look at the links because you showed a lot of very interesting works today. And I think many of our colleagues might be interested in going into more detail of the papers. So really
And
very
I'm also
nice.
happy to answer any questions. I mean, if after the talk, if anybody wants to know
Absolutely.
more, happy to also help. And if anybody wants to help us develop and has some suggestions, we are very open to collaborations.
Absolutely. So I'm really very glad that we have you here for this presentation, and it would be actually wonderful if we could continue. So I think there's quite a few links where we could think about collaborating in the future. And I must really say I'm very impressed by the many different works that you showed today. So I hope that I can play another round of applause. So thank you very much to listening to this video. You have seen there were already plenty of questions that have been asked from our live audience, but of course you still have the chance to ask more questions, and you can simply do this by posting the questions below this video, and I will then contact Ivana such that they can actually be answered. And of course, it would also be a great pleasure for me if you would subscribe to this channel such that you can actually follow more of these presentations, because we will be inviting more guests, of course, also in the future. So thank you very much for watching this video today, and looking forward to meeting you also in future videos. Bye bye.